نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم أما بعد. My dear respected elders, brothers and sisters, today we are inshallah ta'ala dealing with a beautiful surah, Surah Al-Anbiya, and thereafter inshallah we will be speaking of subhanallah Surah Al-Hajj. My beloved, subhanallah, Surah Anbiya has 73 ayat in the Quran al-Kareem. 73 ayat. And it is a Makki surah. Of course, Anbiya, Allah Ta'ala is speaking about the various Nabis that came. This is one of the surahs in the Quran that the surah of the name of the surah is not mentioned in the surah. Like, for example, Baqarah is mentioned in Baqarah, right? Ala Imran is mentioned in Ala Imran. Surah Nisa is mentioned several times in Surah An-Nisa. The word Anbiya is mentioned 5 times or so in the Quran al-Kareem. Anbiya, but it's mentioned in Surah Ma'ida, in Surah Nisa, in other surahs. The word Anbiya is not mentioned in Surah Anbiya. But Surah Anbiya is called Surah Anbiya because Allah Ta'ala makes consecutive mention of many Anbiya in it. So because he's talking of many prophets, so that is why this surah is called Suratul Anbiya, although the actual word Anbiya is not mentioned in it. So now coming back, subhanallah, we find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the very first page of the surah, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ, we did not send before you rasuls illa rijala nuhi ilayhim, except men that we conferred the wahi to. So from here we learn that subhanallah, the anbiya that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent were never women, they were always men. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent men because shouldering the responsibility of a Nabi is not something meager. It's not just easy to shoulder. Even many other men will not be able to do it. For verily, a Nabi is going to be taunted. Nabi is going to be scolded. A Nabi is going to be reprimanded. A Nabi is going to be assassinated. A Nabi is going to be... So subhanallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knew in his infinite mercy that he does not want to confer all this harm and pain to a lady. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shouldered the responsibility of nubuwa upon men. Subhanallah, in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there was actually Musaylamatul Kadhab. And he claimed that he was a Nabi. And he wanted to marry. So there was another lady that she was very intelligent. She knew much of poetry. She claimed that she was a Nabiya, a female prophet. And subhanallah, when the two of them got married, she said to Musaylamatul Kadhab, my dowry unto you is the wahi from Allah that has come up to me, that the Fajr Salah is forgiven from you. And he said, my dowry unto you is Allah has sent the wahi to me that the Isha prayer is forgiven for you. So this is how these, you know, fabricated people came up with, you know, these stories. So someone came to, if I'm not mistaken, one of the Khulafai Rashidin, and she claimed that she was a Nabiya. So subhanallah, the Khalifa told her that Allah's Nabi said, there's no prophet after me. So how can you even claim that prophethood, let alone a female prophet? So she said, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, la Nabiya ba'di. He used the male tense. In other words, he said, there's no male Nabis after me. He never said, there's no female Nabis after me. So subhanallah, you know, there's always a twist and a turn people can make. But this ayah is categorically clear that rijalan nuhi ilayhim, that all the anbiya that we sent, they were men. My beloved, subhanallah, we find that also one thing to know about the anbiya, as we're speaking about the anbiya, is that they are ma'soom. Ma'soom means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has safeguarded them from open sin. A Nabi cannot perform sin. Why? Because a Nabi is a perfect example to us. A Nabi is a perfect example. Uswatun hasana. And if a Nabi does a sin, then what we will say as people, if the Nabi done it, then we can do it. Actually, if you open the Bible and the other scriptures, you will find very derogative, you know, actions, subhanallah, acclaimed that the Anbiya done those things. It will say that Dawud alayhi salatu wasalam drank wine. It will say Sayyidina, you know, a very, very loose character of the Anbiya. right? And it will say they're womanized, na'udhu billah. So if we think of our anbiya like that, if my role model is womanizing, if my role model drinks wine, my role model done all these wrong things, then where do I get my guidance from? And hence, in our belief system, the anbiya are ma'sumeen. Allah has saved them from all types of sin. Yes, they did commit slight errors. Slight errors mean that there were two options and they probably chose not the best option available. And hence we say that subhanAllah, it's an error. A sin is something that you do intentionally to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When Adam alayhi salatu wasalam ate from the tree, he did not eat from the tree to disobey Allah. He ate believing that it will give him a prolonged life in Jannah. Okay? Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, when he said to them, I am sick, and he was not sick, he never mean to lie to offend Allah. If anything, he was trying to giving them a different idea that I'm sick, spiritually sick, to, subhanAllah, not go for the festivity of the idols. So similarly, subhanAllah, when Nuh alayhi salam begged for the forgiveness of his son, it was because he really thought his son was his son, not to offend Allah. However, once Allah Ta'ala made it clear to them that it was wrong, they never repeated and they walked very far away from it. Another thing we know from about the Anbiya, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, Ana khatamul anbiya wa la nabiyya ba'di. I am the final Nabi. I am the final Nabi. And there's no Nabi to come after me. There's no Nabi to come after me. From here we learn that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam was khatamul anbiya. And that's why he had the khatam, the seal of prophethood on his back. It is mentioned it was like the size of a little small egg that protruded from the back. It was very beautiful just on his left shoulder and right at the back of his heart. And that is where, subhanAllah, we know that this was a sign of his finality. And he was the final prophet. There was no Nabi to come after him. So if someone comes and tells you that there's a Nabi, like for example, Musaylamatul Kadhab came, Aswad al-Anasi came, and many imposters. And as recent in, mashallah, when you know the subcontinent was being divided, in order to divide further the ranks of the Muslimin, propped up by the British, subhanAllah, they started a new movement and revolution, the Qadianis. The Qadianis are known as the Ahmadis. Now it's very imperative and important we talk about this. We respect all religions. However, as Muslimin, when we're talking about our religion, we cannot accept such dogmas and such, subhanAllah, perceptions within our ranks of Muslimin. Yes, we respect you. You have the freedom of right of, you know, speech, the freedom of right of practice, as how we have that respect for all other religions. But you can't claim you are Muslim, for verily you go against the fundamental essential of Nubuwwat. And Nubuwwat means Muhammadur Rasulullah is the final Nabi. So now what the Qadiani, they claim that Ahmad al-Qadiani, Ghulam Ahmad al-Mirza al-Qadiani, he was the final prophet. And if you look at the life of Mirza Ghulam Ahmad Qadiani, you will find that it's very erratic. He once claimed that he was, subhanAllah, Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam. Then he claimed that no, he gave birth to Isa alayhi salam. Then he claimed he was Isa himself. Then he claimed he was Mahdi. Then he claimed he was Nabi of Allah. So how can they be, and what he says, my name is Ahmad. And in Surah Saf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذْ قَالَ عِيسَى بْنُ مَرْيَمَ يَا بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ إِنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ إِلَيْكُمْ مُصَدِّقًا لِمَا بَيْنَ يَدَيَّ مِنَ التَّوْرَاةِ وَمُبَشِّرًا بِرَسُولِ يَأْتِي مِنْ بَعْدِ اسْمُهُ أَحْمَدِ. There'll be a Nabi to come after, and his name will be Ahmad. So he claims that I'm that Ahmad. Of course, this is referring to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Isa alayhi salam is giving the glad tidings of Muhammadur Rasulullah. But as Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Muhammadun fil ardi wa Ahmadun fil sama. My name is Muhammad in this earth and I'm Ahmad in the skies. Ahmad, Muhammad, Mahmud all means the same thing, praiseworthy. So subhanAllah, these all are the names of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Just because your name is Ahmad doesn't make you a Nabi. So anyway, this is important for us to know and teach our children, because from every nook, corner and cranny, they are coming out and they are teaching and they are even having masjids. They have 30,000 mosques in the entire world. And one day back in Queensland, I was in Logan and subhanAllah, it is the Sunday market. And I went there and I see, mashallah, da'wah happening, Quran's being given. And I got excited, mashallah, da'wah happening. I just went there to buy some, subhanAllah, plants. So I got behind the, desk. And I said, brother, don't worry, I'll help you give out Qurans. And subhanAllah, as I'm giving out Qurans, my eyes fell on Ahmadiyya. And then I realized, mashallah, for 10 minutes, I was spreading Ahmadiyya Qadianiyism. So subhanAllah, they are out there. Again, respect, we don't have to fight, but in the end of the day, they cannot call themselves Muslims for the simple reason that they do not believe in the finality of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And a person that does not believe in the finality of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is never and can never be a Muslim, because he goes against this fundamental, subhanAllah, essential principle. The Prophet said, the Anbiya are like a huge building, and there was one brick that was left, and I am that brick that fulfills it. Then moving on, my beloveds, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Anbiya speaks about Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. Then he speaks about Lut alayhi salatu wasalam. And then he speaks about Ishaq. And he speaks about Ya'qub alayhi salatu wasalam. Then he brings our attention to Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about an amazing father and his son. Both were given nubuwah, and both were given kingdom. And this was none other than Dawud alayhi salam and Sulaiman alayhi salatu wasalam. See, Dawud alayhi salatu wasalam, he was a simple man. And he would go every day, and Allah Ta'ala says, subhanAllah, he would work. He loved to do work with his hands. And Dawud alayhi salatu wasalam would go and ask the public opinion of what they think about Dawud. We ask people what they think about us because we want to hear the good. Yeah, brother, what do you think? How was my bayan? Brother, what do you think? How was my taraweeh? Brother, you know, subhanAllah, I cook this, mashallah, myself. Yeah, I cooked it. What do you think? So we want to hear the praises, right? Dawud alayhi salatu wasalam would go and ask, why? Just to know what people, what is the criticism, so he could better himself. But for several years, people only had praise. There was nothing to complain about Dawud. What a gentleman he was. Then one day, the malaika, the angels, came in the form of a man. So subhanAllah, the man came up to him and they said, Ya Dawud, salamu alayk. So he makes salam and then he says, look, I want to know what you think about Dawud. He's disguising himself. He's not showing that he's Nabiullah Dawud. So these two men being Anbiya, they said, Dawud is an amazing character, but, oh, he loved this but. This is what he wanted to hear. He wanted to hear what is the negative. So they said, the but is that he does not work. He is dependent on the handouts of people. He eats from what people give him. And Allah Ta'ala loves from a person eats with what his hand earns. So this really struck with Dawud alayhi salatu wasalam. I sit in my mosque all day, and whatever people put their food, I just eat. But I'm not working and earning. So he fell into sajda, and he cried before Allah, and he asked Allah Ta'ala, I don't know how to earn money. Teach me something that I can do and earn my own money. And then Allah inspired him. وَعَلَّمْنَاهُ صَنْعَةَ لَبُوسٍ لَكُمْ Allahu Akbar. Allah Ta'ala says, وَأَلَنَّا لَهُ الْحَدِيدِ And we softened iron and ore for him. And we taught him how to make the armor. And we taught him how to make the shield. And we taught him how to make the sword. So, subhanAllah, he became a blacksmith. And he was able to take the hardest of iron. And Allah made it clay for him. And he would take it, and very easily, mashallah, he would make, subhanAllah, swords and shields and other weaponry, and he would sell it in the market. And subhanAllah, the money he would get from there, he lived off his own hand without begging or asking anyone for handouts. So that is Dawud alayhi salam. Then Allah Ta'ala talks about Sulaiman alayhi salatu wasalam. Now Sayyidina, now Dawud alayhi salam, Allah gave him a very beautiful voice too. And Allah Ta'ala says, Ya jibalu awwibi ma'ahu wat-tayr. Allahu Akbar. When he would recite so beautiful. And it would echo on the mountains of Palestine. And joining in his chorus with the birds. Now you can imagine, such a beautiful melodious tune. He's reciting, the echo is on the mountains. And the birds are tuning in. The echo is there. The chorus is there. That is why it comes that on the day of Qiyamah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask a rendition from Dawud alayhi salatu wasalam to all the believers. Now imagine listening to Dawud alayhi salatu wasalam recite. And then he will say to Muhammad Rasulullah, "O Dawood, you recite from the Zabur." And then he will say, "O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you have mashallah, Qari so-and-so, Qari so-and-so, Qari Naina, mashallah, this Qari, that Qari, Qari Manshawi, Qari Abdul Basit." You know, subhanAllah, when Abdul Nasir of Egypt, when he went to Russia, he told Sheikh Abdul Basit, "I'm going to Russia for a meeting. I want to take you with me." So subhanAllah, Sheikh Abdul Basit, he loved the Quran. Wherever he went, he read Quran. And his intention is, he said, "I would love to read Quran in all four corners of the world." So he went to Russia. So in parliament, all the Russian, you know, subhanAllah, the prime minister and the politicians were all there. And Jamal Abdel Nasser told them that, "You know what, subhanAllah, I just want this man to do an Islamic prayer." And they said that, "Sheikh Abdul Basit, can you believe, you till today we listen to his recordings and we shiver. He read a live rendition of Surah Rahman in the parliament of Russia. And when he finished, all the politicians had tears in their eyes." That's the power of the Quran, Sheikh Abdul Basit reciting. On the day of Qiyamah, Dawood alayhi salam will recite. And then Rasulullah will recite. And then for the believers, Allah will recite. Can you believe Allah reciting Surah Rahman? May Allah Ta'ala grant us that, inshallah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those moments where we hear the Anbiya and Allah recite for us. So anyway, continuing, Allahu Akbar, Sayyidina Dawood alayhi salatu was salam. Coming to Sulaiman alayhi salatu was salam, was his son. And Allah speaks about an incident when someone came and they had a problem. It was about, you know, partners. This guy's, subhanAllah, his sheep went this side and he ate his grass and all these things happened. So they came with the case to Sayyidina Dawood alayhi salatu wasalam. Dawood alayhi salatu wasalam passed the fatwa, but it was not very, subhanAllah, you know, conducive. So then they went to Sulaiman alayhi salatu wasalam, the son. Sulaiman alayhi salatu wasalam, Allah says, فَفَهَّمْنَاهَا سُلَيْمَانَ. We gave the knowledge of that matter to Sulaiman alayhi salatu wasalam. And Sulaiman alayhi salam solved it amicably. What we learn from this, that it does not mean you know a lot, that you know everything. Sometimes even your juniors can solve and sort out things that seniors can't. You might know a lot, but there are certain things Allah has placed a speciality with everyone, that Dawood alayhi salam is the father, Dawood alayhi salam is the Nabi, Dawood alayhi salam is the king, and he has a son, Sulaiman. But Dawood alayhi salam could not solve the problem, Sulaiman solved the problem. Allah gave the knowledge to Sulaiman alayhi salam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam in Hudaybiyah, he wanted to go for Umrah, and the kuffar, subhanAllah, they stopped him, they intercepted him, and now he did not know what to do. So he had to turn back, of course. So the Sahaba were very, very upset. The Sahaba wanted to go for Umrah. And Umar radiallahu anhu came and he said, "Ya Rasulullah, are we not on the truth? Did Allah not promise us an Umrah? Why should we turn back? We will take it in our arms and we will go and fight them and make the Umrah." And Rasulullah s.a.w. said, "No." When this was happening, my beloved, subhanAllah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam became very worried, because he came to his tent and he was looking very, very worried. So his wife, Ummi Salima radiallahu anha, said, "O Prophet of Allah, why do you look so worried?" He said, "Because I am fearful if I, subhanAllah, I am telling my Sahaba to turn back and go back to Medina, and they are not listening to me. And if they do not listen to me and Allah gets angry, I fear Allah will punish them." So Ummi Salima radiallahu anha at that time gave such a small solution, but it was the best solution. She said, "Ya Rasulullah, don't say anything. Just don't say anything. Just you yourself cut your hair, slaughter your sheep, and go back to Medina. And who will want to make Umrah without you? Everyone will follow you." So he said, "Oh, okay." He slaughtered his sheep, he cut his hair, and he went back. And then the Sahaba said, "We can't make Umrah without Rasulullah." So they just followed. So what I'm saying is, subhanAllah, sometimes the solution of the matter is so easy. I was reading that other day in one of the journals that BMW made a car. Now they, subhanAllah, created this car in a specific factory, and the doorway of the factory is made for only certain cars of height to come out. And they increased the height of the specific car by few inches, not realizing that after, subhanAllah, they make the car, it will not be able to go through the entry that normally the cars go through. So they created the car. Now it's few inches higher. After the car is created, it's amazing car, everyone is looking at it. Now the car needs to go down and out of the entrance. They realize it's just a few inches high. So they called all the, subhanAllah, the engineers that look, now we're stuck with the car. So many cars we made, amazingly, we never think about, you know what, the entry is a little lower. Or the boot of spring or something of that sort. It's a bit lower. Now how are we going to get it through? So they're thinking of what we can do. And some is saying that maybe we have to do this, lower the suspension, do that, do that, do that. And then they call the builders. Can we, you know, subhanAllah, do some building renovations too? And there's hours of all these, subhanAllah, high-tech people thinking. And then the normal cleaner said, I have a solution. So they said, what's your solution? He said, flatten the tire, the car will roll out. Flatten the tire, the car will roll out. So sometimes, you know, we can't fit anywhere and we have problems with a lot of people. You know why? Because our ego is too fat. We need to just deflate our ego and a lot of things will happen, inshallah ta'ala. So my beloveds, Allahu Akbar. Sometimes the solution, in India one day there was an elephant running wild. The elephant was causing havoc. It stampeded everything, subhanAllah. So they could not bring that elephant under control, Allahu Akbar. And one little kid came and he says, I know how to bring him under control. They said, you, what are you going to do? He said, listen to me. He took a little puppy, you know, dog, puppy. He took the puppy and he started, subhanAllah, swirling the puppy. And then he threw the puppy on the face of the elephant. Now you can imagine the puppy howling and growling and barking. And then it hit the elephant. It shocked the elephant. And the elephant just stood still for a while. And quickly they chained the legs and they're able to get the elephant under control. So sometimes Allah Ta'ala gives ideas to smaller people and junior people. So we should never be, subhanAllah, shy to ask mashwara from everyone. Sulaiman alayhi salatu wasalam, look at this. It comes in hadith. Two women came to him. They first went to Dawood alayhi salatu wasalam. They said, Ya Dawood, this child is my child. The other lady said, no, it's not her child, it's my child. So now Dawood alayhi salatu wasalam did not know whose child it is. So he tried to look at the resemblance of the child and look at the women. And he came to the conclusion that it's the son of the lady that was not the mother. So they were not happy. So the other lady took her to Sulaiman alayhi salatu wasalam. He said, Ya Sulaiman, your father gave verdict like this, but I'm not happy with the verdict because I know it's my child. The other lady said, it's my child. So Sulaiman alayhi salatu wasalam took out a sword. He put the child in the middle. And he said, I'm going to cut the child in half and you can take this half and you can take the other half. You're both fighting. What are we going to do now? Just cut the child in half. You take the other half. You take the other half. So the one lady, she done like this. The other lady said, no, 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 no. You can never do like this. Never mind. Just give it to her. Sulaiman said, she's the mother. A mother will rather give her child away, but will never see her child being killed. The lady that was not ready to accept the child to be cut, she is the mother and gave the child to the other lady. So that's why Allah Ta'ala says we gave the hikmah and understanding to Sulaiman alayhi salatu wassalam. Then after that, my beloveds, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about Ayyub alayhi salam. He speaks about Ismail alayhi salam. He speaks about Idris alayhi salam. He speaks about Zilkifl. And then he speaks about Dhunnun. Who's Dhunnun? Dhunnun, Sayyidina Yunus alayhi salam. Noon in Arabic is fish. The noon, the one of the fish. Wa Dhunnun is Dhahaba Mughadiban. And the one of the fish, when he went angrily and he left, subhanAllah, from his nation. Why the one of the fish? Because the fish swallowed him, subhanAllah. And Sayyidina Yusha bin Noon also, we call him Yusha bin Noon. He's also the one of the fish with Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam. We read his story today that Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam was looking for Khidr alayhi salatu wasalam, and he had his fatah, his young boy with him, Yusha bin Noon. And after Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, he became a Nabi as well. So that's a different Yusha bin Noon. Ya wa dan Noon is Yunus alayhi salatu wasalam. And then Allah Ta'ala talks about Zakariya alayhi salatu wasalam. And Allah Ta'ala talks about Sayyidina Yahya alayhi salatu wasalam. That brings us an end to Surah Anbiya. Now we go to Surah Hajj. Now we go to Surah Hajj. Surah Hajj is a Madani Surah. And subhanAllah, Allahu Akbar, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions Hajj here. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the sacrifices of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam and how Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam called the people to Hajj. First, Allah ta'ala says that Allah ta'ala inspired Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam and Ismail alayhi salam, tahira, baytia, cleanse and clean my home. Clean my home from what? From shirk. People would make shirk by the Kaaba. And that's why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he came to Makkah al-Mukarramah, the first thing he done was to go into the Kaaba and break all the idols. Ja'a al-haqqu wa zahaqa al-batil. The haqq has come and the batil is to be, subhanallah, eradicated. Now my beloved, subhanallah, Allah has made the Maqam Ibrahim. The Maqam Ibrahim is a place where Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa sallam stood upon. And Allah Ta'ala allowed the Maqam Ibrahim to be an elevator for Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam, and it took him all around the Kaaba and allowed him to be on a certain level to be able to, subhanAllah, build the Kaaba. It is mentioned from Abdullah bin Abbas and many other Mufassirin that even in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the feet and the prints of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam was always on that rock. Until today we can see the footsteps of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam on that rock. But that rock was adjacent directly to the Kaaba. It was directly adjacent to the Kaaba. Sayyidina Umar bin Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu is the one that, subhanallah, moved that rock away from the Kaaba little bit into the Mataf area. Until today it is in the Mataf area where Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu placed it. In the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it was adjacent to the Kaaba. Right? Now that is the Maqam Ibrahim. And he says, why did he cleanse the Kaaba? بالطائفين والعاكفين والركع والسجود للركع السجود. So he cleansed the Kaaba for people to make tawaf, for people to make i'tikaf, for people to make ruku and sujood. That's why the greatest thing to do by the Kaaba is to make tawaf. There's no greater ibadah in Makkah after the fara'id than to make tawaf. Because you can make salah, you can keep fast everywhere in the world. But to make tawaf, you can only make it in Makkah. So the greatest thing is to make tawaf. And anyone by the Kaaba doing anything, Allah gives them reward. So Nabi Kareem, there's a hadith, there's more than 100 rewards and mercies that comes every day down. So much is for those who make tawaf. So much for those who make salah. So much for those. And even those who just sit and look at the Kaaba, they also get the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the Kaaba, my beloveds. Now coming back. وَإِذْ بَوَّعْنَا لِإِبْرَاهِيمَ الْبَيْتَ. And when we inspired Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam to build the Kaaba, to build the house, he left Ismail alayhi salatu wasalam and he went. And when he came back to Makkah, now Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam sees Ismail alayhi salatu wasalam was of age. And then you remember, of course, subhanAllah, he had to sacrifice him. And after they passed that test, then Allah Ta'ala then gives them the honor of building the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, subhanAllah, Allah says to Ibrahim alayhi salam after he builds the house, وَأَذِّنْ فِي النَّاسِ بِالْحَجِّ, and announce amongst the people for Hajj, يَأْتُوكَ رِجَالًا, they will come on foot, وَعَلَى كُلِّ ضَامِرٍ, and they will come on their animals, right? And they will come مِنْ كُلِّ فَجٍّ عَمِيكٍ, from every distant corner of the world. Today you go for Hajj, mashallah. People from Canada, people from Norway, people from Finland, people from New Zealand, people from China, people from Japan, people from Africa, from every nook and alley, from small islands, people are coming for Hajj. This is the prophecy Allah gave Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. لِيَشْهَدُوا مَنَافِعَ لَهُمْ, so they may witness the benefits for them. They may benefit from the sacrificial animals. And لِيَذْكُرُوا اسْمَ اللَّهِ فِي أَيَّامٍ مَعْدُودَاتٍ, and they may take the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in few days. My beloveds, I'll tell you something. Allah Ta'ala gives power. Allah Ta'ala gives power. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives, subhanAllah, effect with sacrifice. Without sacrifice, there's not much of effect. Look at this. Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam was a young boy. Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam was young and energetic. Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam was eloquent in speech. Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam had the energy of the world. Ibrahim alayhi salam was in the prime of his youth. Ibrahim alayhi salam had the loudest of voices. Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam was charismatic. Ibrahim alayhi salam was handsome. Ibrahim alayhi salam had it all for him. Yet when he gave dawah to the king in all his power and in all his excellence, the king never accepted. He gave dawah to his own father, Azar. Azar never accepted. He gave dawah to his own brethren and his people around him, and they never accept. Why? Because behind the qawl of Ibrahim alayhi salam, there was eloquence, there was charismatic nature, there was, subhanallah, a young handsome boy, but there was no mujahada and struggle. And then Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam was put on the highway of problems, and the highway and the freeway of test after test after test. وَإِذِ ابْتَلَى إِبْرَاهِيمَ رَبُّهُ بِكَلِمَاتٍ فَأَتَمَّهُنَّ. Allah says, and then we riddled Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam with test after test. فَأَتَمَّهُنَّ. Firstly, the test of his life. They threw him in the fire, and alhamdulillah, he passed that test. Then the test of his wife and his child. He had to leave them in the barren land of Makkah, and he passed that test. And then the test of sacrificing his son, and he passed that test. And another thousands of other tests that Allah Ta'ala put on Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. Now Ibrahim becomes feeble. Ibrahim becomes weak. Ibrahim loses his voice. Ibrahim is over 100 years old. Ibrahim is hunched. Ibrahim is in the middle of nowhere, in the middle of a desert. And now Ibrahim builds the house of Allah. And now Allah says, Ibrahim, call the world. He says, Ya Allah, I was young, and I was eloquent, and I was charismatic, and I was handsome, and I was powerful, and my own father never accepted. And now I'm old and crunched and hunched, and I'm in the middle of a desert, and you want the whole world to listen to me. Oh, Ibrahim, now you have a life of sacrifice behind you, and you have the qubuliyat of Allah with you. That is what matters, oh, Ibrahim. We don't see the sound system. We don't see the acoustics. We don't see, subhanAllah, how big the crowd is. We see the heart. We see the mujahada. That is what we want. Ibrahim, adhin fi nasi bil hajj. You make the adhan. Let alone, there's no one in front of you. We will take your voice to every hajar and shajar, to every hut, to every mud hut, to every brick hut. We will take it to the furthest corners of the world. We'll take it in this time, through time, till the last day. We'll take it in the skies, in the heavens, and every ruh and every soul that is unborn will hear your da'wah, O Ibrahim alayhi salam. And Ibrahim with his feeble voice said, oh people, come for hajj, for the pleasure of Allah. And Allah made that echo. Ibn Abbas says, every tree said labbaik, every mountain said labbaik, every lake said labbaik, every being at that time that was living said labbaik, and Allah Ta'ala echoed his voice to the seven heavens, and every soul that was unborn heard it, and those that said labbaik will go for hajj, and those that said labbaik twice will go for hajj twice, and those that said labbaik 40 times will go for hajj 40 times. That's the power of sacrifice and qubuliyat of Allah. Sahaba, then what Allah says, وَإِذِ ابْتَلَى إِبْرَاهِيمَ رَبُّهُ. When Allah tested Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, فَأَتَمَّهُنْ, he passed it, he passed his test. Then what Allah conferred upon him now the title. Allah now confers him the title. You graduate from the madrasa of Allah. Not from Cambridge, not from Howard, not from this Darul Uloom or that institute. Now you are graduate from the madrasa of Allah. Who is the teacher? Allah. Where's the classroom? Your life. Every time, problems, the patience, the du'as. That is the graduation. And once you reach graduation, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes you a beacon of hidayah. Allah says, and he graduates Ibrahim from the madrasa of Allah. And what he gives him? What title?
قال إني جاعلك للناس إماما.
Oh Ibrahim, now you're an imam. Ibrahim, now you're a leader. Ibrahim, now you don't even have to talk. You walk, people will walk behind you. You don't have to scream, Ibrahim. Now you don't have to scream. You just walk, people will walk behind you. Ibrahim alayhi salam, كان أمّة واحدة. Put an entire nation on one side. Ibrahim, one man alone is equal to a nation. Allahu Akbar. Same thing with the Sahaba, my beloveds. They were, subhanAllah, downtrodden. They were, subhanAllah, drinking liquor. They were, subhanAllah, maiming. They were raping. They were doing a lot of wrong things. Rasulullah SAW came. He changed their hearts. He gave them, alhamdulillah, the call of Iman. It reawakened them. They changed their lives. And there, subhanAllah, They were young. They were strong. They called their own folks. They called their own brothers. They called their own mothers to Islam, but they never accept. And then they had to sacrifice for 13 years. They were maimed. They were hit. They were lashed. They were taunted. They were tormented. They were assassinated. Allahu Akbar. And they had to go. Khabbab had to burn his back. Bilal had to be dragged. Sumayyah had to be pierced. And many of them had to make them immigration to Abyssinia. And 13 years riddled with problems and sacrifice for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My beloveds, Allahu Akbar. After all those years of sacrifice, the sacrifices of Ibrahim alayhi salam was put on them. And because they were with Rasulullah, they even had to give greater sacrifices. If Ibrahim alayhi salatu was salam, had to put himself in a fire, but he was ransomed and taken out. Sahaba had to put themselves on Badr, on Uhud, on Khandaq, and they gave their lives. They were never ransomed to come back. If Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam left his wife and his child in Makkah, years later he was reconciled with them. When Sahaba left their wives at home, asked little Bashir, he's 12 years old and he's waiting for his father to come back, never came back. Ask the children of Ja'far radiallahu anhu. They were 2, 4, 7, and they were waiting. Their father never come back. Sahaba, when they went out, they were never to return. Allahu Akbar. And when Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam had Ismail alayhi salatu wasalam, and Ismail was put there and he slaughtered, and when he opened his eyes, he was ransomed and Ismail was given back to them. On the battle of Badr, father had to take out his sword against his son. Son had to take out his sword against his father. And no ransom animal came between. They had to slaughter their father and slaughter their son for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu in the battle of Badr, he was running. His son was not a Muslim at that time. He was on the kufar side. Later on, he accepted Islam. He said, "Oh Abu Bakr, oh my father, I saw you on Badr and I had full chance to kill you. But being my father, I spared you." Abu Bakr said, "Had I seen you, I would have not spared you. My Allah is my priority." And when Sahaba done these sacrifices, then how Allah gave the mantle of imamat to Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam, Allah gave the mantle to the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum wa radu an. Allah is pleased with the Sahaba and they are pleased with him. Ashabi kan nujum, my Sahaba are like shining stars. Bi'ayhi muqtadaytum ihtadaytum, any of my Sahaba you follow, you will be rightly guided. So my beloved, subhanallah, my main point today from the stories of the Anbiya is that to be impactful, to have power behind your da'wah, to be a leader, it doesn't come with fancy causes. It doesn't come with fancy mosques. It doesn't come with fancy setups. It doesn't come with fancy structures. It comes all with a very clean and a sincere heart. And it comes with hard work and sacrifice behind and crying behind the curtains. And slowly but surely, Allah Ta'ala models your life and He becomes your murabbi, your molder. And slowly when you reach those high stations, then He opens the doors of Hidayat and it floods and thousands of people are guided on your hands. But that comes from Him. No one can give it to you in this world. How? Ibrahim earned it and Sahaba earned it. May Allah Ta'ala grant it to us. So my beloveds, in a nutshell, that was Surah Anbiya for you. The Surah of all the Anbiya and Surah Hajj, where Allah Ta'ala mentions Ibrahim alayhi salam calling humanity to Hajj inshaAllah Ta'ala. We will continue tomorrow. Wa akhir da'wan alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.